will be talking about a very important disease in the world, which is not afflicting the society from the economy perspective, but also socially, and mental health is also affected by this disease. The name of the disease is diabetes mellitus, and it is now going to affect almost 9% of the world population, which is obviously a huge number. It doesn't only affect the health of the society and the patient, it also affects the socio-economic indicators because it burns a lot of the resources of the society. So let's talk about the diabetes mellitus, and specifically in this video we will talk about the type 2 diabetes mellitus, because in the coming video our topic of the discussion will be type 1 diabetes mellitus. So let's talk about the diabetes mellitus type 2. So let's first of all define what is type 2 or what is diabetes mellitus as a whole. What is diabetes mellitus? We have been hearing this name for a longer period of time. Perhaps when someone starts thinking of becoming a doctor, and from the very outset one gets to know about this name, diabetes mellitus. So the definition of the diabetes mellitus is, it's a state of a chronic state of hyperglycemia. So there are two very important words in this definition. One, it is a chronic state. It doesn't come and go. It does not happen to the patient and is treated like the pneumonia, like the tuberculosis, like any other infection, be on the skin or inside of the body. But this is some kind of a problem which stays there. It's not a curable disease, but it's a manageable disease. There are so many people in the world, almost this is going to be approximately 9% of the world population, which is being affected by this disease, but it stays there. It's a chronic problem. It's manageable, but it's not curable. So it's a chronic state of hyperglycemia. Now, when the word comes glycemia, we give our attention to the blood sugar level. Blood sugar level. So whenever the blood sugar level is higher than a certain value, we call it the hyperglycemia, mean the sugar, emia mean the presence in the blood. So whenever blood sugar or glucose level in the blood is above a certain value, we call it hyperglycemia. For example, if you haven't taken your breakfast and you're sort of hungry or starving for the last 10 to 12 hours, and you check your blood sugar, and if it is more than 126, then that falls in this category of the hyperglycemia. But there is a obviously there are certain factors to it, which I am going to talk in a while. But fasting blood sugar is the one where we see that if a person hasn't taken anything and the blood sugar level is more than 126 milligram per deciliter, it falls into the category of the hyperglycemia. But if you have taken the food and it is checked after certain hours, probably 2 hours, then we call it the postprandial or random blood sugar. Now if you check your random blood sugar and if it is more than 200 milligram per deciliter, we call it that probably the patient needs to be seen if he or she falls in the category of the hyperglycemia. So diabetes mellitus definition is a chronic state of hyperglycemia, and which afflicts more than 9% of the world population, which is a huge number of the people. So this is definition. Now there are two types of the diabetes mellitus, type 1 and type 2. Types of the diabetes mellitus are types. These are type 1 type 2. Because our major discussion today will stay up towards the type 2 diabetes mellitus, but here this is important just to say a few lines about the type 1. Type 1 diabetes mellitus happens in the young and juvenile patient, and there is an immune destruction of the source of the insulin, because blood glucose level is managed. Or for example, if I eat something which is sweet, the glucose will go in my blood, will be reabsorbed or absorbed through the gut into my blood, and then pancreas has got beta cells. They will release the insulin. The insulin will make it possible for the glucose to enter from the blood to the inside of the cells, where it will be metabolized, and after metabolism it will create adenosine triphosphate as an energy source. So there is a troika, where we see the insulin, where we see the glucose, and where we see the ATP production, which we all need for our functions, brain functions and other body functions. So what happens in type 1? There is an immune destruction of the source of the insulin from the beta cell. Beta cells are destroyed. So these patients who are young, they do not have any insulin. That is why whenever you see a young patient who is labeled as the diabetic, they are probably being treated by the insulin only, because they have got immune destruction of their beta cell of the pancreas. But in case of the type 2 diabetic, they have got a very strong family history, because there are certain genes on in our body which predispose us to the development of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. Now, for example, if both the parents are diabetic, then there are 50% chances that if they have got a monozygotic twins, both of them will be diabetic. But if one of the parent is diabetic, or there is dizygotic twin, or otherwise, if these kids are not twins, they have got the 20% chances of contracting or developing the type 2 diabetes mellitus. So it has got a strong family history, it has got a strong inheritance, it has got a strong genetic association. But there is no destruction of the beta cell. Now, in case of the type 2 diabetes mellitus, rather than the deficiency of the insulin, there is a problem of its function on the cells. It works on the muscles and the adipose tissue. Insulin does a very important job. It makes it possible for the glucose to be transported inside of these cells, where they are metabolized and there is ATP production. But in case of the type 2 problem, type 2 diabetes mellitus problem, the initial problem at least is the resistance of the action of the insulin. It's not the availability, it's action, it's resistant. There is a problem on the receptors which doesn't let the insulin work. So if you see majority of these patients, they are more than 30 years old, they have got a strong family history. When you see their treatment plans, you will see that in majority of these patients, they are put on the oral treatment. For example, metformin, which is a big one, I do, and we will talk about it. So what that drug does, it just makes the resistance of the insulin action on the receptor less and less and less. So, but ultimately, as the time passes, their beta cells, they are also exhausted. They also stop production of the insulin. So ultimately, along with the medications, these patients will also end up with the insulin and the oral treatment, like the biguanides and the sulfonylureas and the other drugs. So the major difference between the type 1 and the type 2, these are non-immune mediated. This is type 1 is immune mediated. There is an absolute deficiency of the insulin. There may be insulin deficiency, but there is a resistance problem in type 2. These are thin and lean patients. These are overweight patients. Why these are thin and lean? Because when there is no insulin, the body needs ATP. Body will be making glucose inside of the liver from the fats and the protein. The fats will be coming from the obviously whatever we eat, and it ends up as an adipose tissue or as a fatty tissue, but and then it gets converted into the glycerol, and it is available to the liver for the gluconeogenesis, which is the formation of the glucose from the non-glucose sources. And also the muscles, they release the alanine. Now that alanine, which is a protein, is used by the liver to form more and more glucose. Now what happens that they lose the muscle mass and the fats, they become thin and lean. But majority of these patients are in type 2 diabetic, they are obese. Now there is a very interesting phenomena about the type 2 diabetes mellitus. In the rich countries, poor are diabetic. And in the poor countries or the developing countries like Pakistan, this is known as the disease of the affluent society. What is the central thing between two groups is the obesity. Obesity makes the problem worse, it causes the problem. In the affluent society, the poor people are more obese, and in the developing worlds, the rich people, they are more obese. So obesity causes the development of the type 2 diabetes mellitus and it worsens it. In fact, there is a terminology which we call the metabolic syndrome, which is a very sort of disputed terminology. When you see a person who is obese, has got a body mass index more than 30 kilogram per square meters, and you patient is diabetic, that person is hypertensive, is obese, and has got a triglyceride level on the higher side, and they have got a HDL cholesterol on the lower side. Now that will be known as the metabolic syndrome, and that makes one very vulnerable for the development of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. So obesity is a real problem. So always educated these patients to avoid obesity. And the biggest reason of being obese is not that we are taking much. This is what happens actually after 25 years of age or 30 years of age up till the 55, that we are always taking something which is extra than what we need, because we are in that age, we become sufficient enough to make enough money that we can feed ourselves. And as a human nature goes, the humans, they are always eating. The problem is not the intake of the energies, but it is the expenditure. If one is doing the regular exercises, at least 30 minutes a day, at least 5 times a week, then patient, for the chances of developing the obesity is the least. So try to make it your habit that you should not be you should not give up on doing exercises. Try to watch what you are eating, because obesity is the central point for the development of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. Other than the genetic inheritance, other than inflammation, other than the resistance, because obesity also increases the resistance somehow. So last thing about this thing, when you are to ask someone, or when you are to think yourself what kind of a diet I need to, one, avoid the obesity and to properly manage or avoid the development of the type 2 diabetes mellitus, or to prevent the type 2 diabetes mellitus, your diet should be very specific. Only 30% of the energy should come from your fats. 30% of the energies should only come from the fat, and that too also should include polyunsaturated but no saturated fats. You should avoid taking the saturated fats, avoid taking bakery items, avoid taking, you can take the skim milk, you can take olive oils, you can take avocado, but you should avoid the unsaturated fats. So, and 40 to 60% of your energy should come from the carbohydrates. When you are to think about the diet and also advise the diet to the patient, then take these things into account. The fat should, the energy composition of the diet should include 30% energy should come from the fat, 40 to 60% should come from the carbohydrates, and these carbohydrates should be low glycemic index diet. Low glycemic index diet. Just to give you a couple of examples, for example, if there are two persons, one is eating the pasta and one is eating the white potato as a source of the carbohydrate, then the glycemic index or the content of the energies in the white potatoes is high as compared to the pasta. Pasta is a favorable thing for these patients, but white potatoes is not. Likewise, if you are hooked to the habit of taking tea or coffee, then you should use this artificial sweeteners rather than the sugar, because that is also a bad thing for these patients. And the protein intake should be 1 gram per kg per kilogram, 1 gram per kg per day. That is around 70 to 100 gram per day protein is required for these patients. So this is the diet plan for the prevention of the type 2 diabetes mellitus and obesity. And one very important thing, insulin is required for the transfer of the glucose from the blood to the inside of the cell, but this does not happen with the brain. Brain does not rely on these things. Brain does not rely on the insulin for the shifting of the glucose to the brain. Brain only relies on the glucose. So whenever you are in hypoglycemia, the person or you will become faint. You will be unconscious. Why? Because your brain only needs a glucose for its survival, and it does not need insulin to shift the glucose from the blood to the brain. So these are certain important factors. So after we have talked about these things, there are certain receptors which we call the glucose transporting receptors, and they are located on different cells. There are four types of the glucose transported receptor, which we call the GLUT, glucose transporter. 1, 2, 3 and 4. Let's talk about the 1, 2 and 3, where they are located and what's their importance. They shift the glucose from outside of the body, outside of the cells, from inside the blood to the inside of the cell. Glucose GLUT1 are located on those cells which are not insulin dependent for the shift of the glucose to inside of the cell. GLU2 are located on the beta cells for the shift of the glucose from outside of the beta cells to the inside. Because what happens in for example, if this is a beta cell, if this is a beta cell and these are it's a cell membrane. Now what happens that for these beta cells which are located in the pancreas and which form the which secrete the insulin. So the source of the insulin in the body is from the beta cells of the pancreas. Pancreas is located where there is a duodenum. It's the head of the pancreas, tail of the pancreas and body of the pancreas. So it's located near duodenum, and it's secreting there the beta cells, and they are secreting the blood, the insulin in the blood. So it's the endocrine function of the pancreas. So what happens that in these beta cells there are some receptors which we call the glucose transfer receptor. For example, these are located here. For example, glucose come from outside. These are GLU2 receptors, and these are located on the beta cells of pancreas. Glucose enters from outside or from the blood, and it enters into the inside of the beta cells. Here metabolism happens. This metabolism generates ATP, adenosine triphosphate. Now this ATP, it performs a very important functions. There is another receptors. These receptor will be known as the ATP dependent potassium receptors. These are ATP dependent potassium channels or receptor. Now potassium is going outside of the beta cells. Now what does this ATP does? It actually inhibits the transfer or outside removal of the potassium. Now there is a membrane depolarization as a result of it, and what will happen that there are calcium channels present here. Now these receptors are the calcium channels. Now once the membrane is depolarized, a lot of calcium influx happens. A lot of calcium comes from outside to the inside of the cells, and then there is a receptor. There are hormones which are phosphorylase, kinase, calcium dependent phosphorylase, kinase hormone. They will cause the release of insulin from the vesicle. There are certain vesicles which are located inside of the beta cells. They will release the insulin, or exocytosis of the insulin happens. So this is the importance of the glucose transport receptor, and they are located on the insulin. And from where this insulin came, actually, if I make another beta receptor here, if this is the beta receptor and it has got a nucleus here, it's the nucleus of the beta receptor, and here we have ribosomes which are located on the endoplasmic reticulum. These are ribosomes which are associated with the messenger RNA. Ribosome. These are associated, this is the endoplasmic reticulum. Endoplasmic reticulum. And it has got ribosomes which are associated with the messenger RNA. And this is how they start formation of a hormone which we call the, or you can make it like this. This is known as the pro-insulin. Now here we are talking from where the insulin came actually. This pro-insulin, then it is shifted to, this is shifted to the Golgi complex. This is the Golgi apparatus. Cis and transformation, conformation of the Golgi apparatus. These are the Golgi apparatus. Golgi apparatus. Now what happens inside of the Golgi apparatus, that this pre-pro insulin is converted into the pro-insulin. Pro-insulin. So from here, like say this was the pre-pro insulin, now it has lost a part of it. For example, a part of this here is lost, then it will be something like this. So this is pro-insulin. Now this pro-insulin from the Golgi apparatus is shifted to the inside of the secretory vesicles, which are located these one. These are the secretory vesicles. These pro-insulin, when they are converted into the insulin, it loses this C-peptide or the connecting peptide, and these are released into the blood. So insulin and C-peptide, they are released into the blood by the process of this whole formation, and that is, that gives us a very important clue. If you receive a patient who's having a recurrent hypoglycemia, and you want to know if this patient has used fictitious insulin or has injected himself or herself insulin, you try to measure the serum level of the insulin and C-peptide. If the serum insulin level and C-peptide level both are raised, then there is some sort of problem inside of the pancreas where there is an increased formation and secretion of the insulin. But if only the insulin is on the higher side but C-peptide is not, then probably the chances are that the patient himself or somebody have injected him with a higher dosage of the insulin. This is very important clinical correlation. So from here these vesicles come, and ultimately they are released when the glucose enters through the glucose transporter to receptor. So this is how it is done. Now glucose transport three receptors, they are located inside the brain. Glucose transporter GLUT3, they are located in the brain, and they do not need insulin for the transfer of the glucose from outside or from the blood to the brain cells. Lastly, glucose transporter receptor 4, they are located at the target cell of insulin, target tissues of the insulin, like the muscles and adipose tissue. On the muscles and the adipose tissue, we have these glucose transporter receptor 4. And for example, if I make here this target cell, this is a target cell, what will happen that once inside receptor are located, for example, there are, now this is the alpha and this is the beta unit of the, this is the insulin receptor. It has got, one is the alpha unit and this is the beta unit of the insulin receptor. This whole is the insulin receptor. There is a very specific thing about the beta subunit, that it sorts of sits on the both side of the cell membrane. What happens that if this is the insulin, it comes and attaches with the insulin receptor, and it will start certain changes inside the beta unit that will send a signal to the inside of the cell, and there are these secretory vesicles which not only contain the insulin inside, but there are also glucose within the, there are certain receptor which we call the GLUT4 receptor, but they are inside of the cell sitting and waiting for the orders to come from the insulin. Once it gets attached to the receptor, which has got alpha and beta subunit, and beta has got two portion. One is inside of the outside of the cell membrane, and in the second is inside. It is sort of straddling on the cell membrane. So once it has got the orders, the GLUT4 receptor, they will go from here and they will be on the cell membrane. And this is how in the muscle and the adipose tissue, this glucose will be shifted from outside. This glucose comes from outside through the GLUT4 receptors, and it will be metabolized, and it will be used for the formation of the ATP and the energy and metabolism. Metabolism results in the formation of the energy, which is much needed, and which is the core of this whole story. When I need energy, I'll take something. It will be either glucose, or ultimately will get converted into the glucose with the help of the gluconeogenesis in the liver. Then this is what I'm talking about, the fed state or the postprandial state. Now from there, the glucose will be shifted inside the target cells, which are the muscle and the adipose tissue, and they will form the ATP or the energy. And this is what we are working for. This is the carbon cycle where we eat, we excrete, we eat, we excrete, and we need to, for our engines to work, this energy is much needed for all of us. So this is a basic idea about the diabetes mellitus and insulin and glucose. So what are the clinical features in these patients? Once we have seen these basic things, let's talk about the clinical features of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. Now the clinical feature can be acute, subacute, and they sometimes present with the complications. It can be acute, it can be subacute, and sometimes the patient presents with the complications. We are talking about the clinical feature or the clinical presentation. This is a clinical presentation of the patient. So the classical presentation will be the acute one, which though happens most of the time in the patients of the type 1 diabetes mellitus, but it can be also here. Sometimes they lose weight loss. It can be
यूरिया, पोलीडिप्सिया, सो एंड दे मे ऑलवेज बी थर्स्टी, दैट गोज विद इट, दे आर ऑलवेज बी आस्किंग फॉर मोर एंड मोर वाटर. So the acute presentation, though it happens in majority of the type 1 diabetes mellitus patient, but it can be that these patients are always asking for water. Why? Because there is a concept of the renal threshold. What happens in renal threshold? That in the proximal convoluted tubules, if this is the Bowman's capsule, this is proximal convoluted tubule, loop of Henle, both ascending, descending, thick and thin, and distal convoluted tubule. So what happens in the proximal convoluted tubules, that whenever the blood sugar goes higher than 180 milligram per deciliter inside of the blood, it starts flowing in the tubules. So this is known as the renal threshold. Though it varies a lot, it can vary from like 273 milligram per deciliter on the higher side up to like 100 or 73 milligram per deciliter on the lower side of the threshold. But this is the threshold on average. If the blood glucose goes higher than 180 milligram per deciliter, there are chances that it would start being filtered. Now, once then there comes a time that these obviously majority of the glucose normally is reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubules, but once they get saturated, it keeps coming down the hill, it keeps coming outside of the tubules, and it is excreted out of the body. Now, it has got one very important thing, that it's a osmotically very active agent, glucose. So it drags fluid along with it. So whenever there is hyperglycemia, and whenever their glucosuria, which is the removal of the glucose or excretion of the glucose along with the urine, then a lot of fluid will also be dragged along with it. Patient will be passing a lot of urine, which we call the polyuria. Patient will be dehydrated and thirsty and will be asking for the fluid most of the time, which we call the polydipsia, and patient is asking for to drink water more and more. Why there is a weight loss? Though it happens in the type 1 diabetics. But if the type 2 goes undiagnosed, there is a lot of blood sugar, glucose present in the blood, but none is present in the inside of the cells, or least amount is present inside of the cell. The cell turns towards the fats and the muscles. As a gluconeogenesis or non-glucose source from the body, they will use the fats and the muscles, and this is how the patient can lose the weight. So this is the acute presentation in these patients, though that acute presentation is in majority of the type 1, but in type 2 also it can happen. So what are the subacute presentation along with the acute feature, like the polydipsia, polyuria and thirst and the weight loss? Patient may have the visual blurring. Patient may have the eyesight problem, sometime as a presenting feature. Patient may have lack of energy. Patient may have decreased sexual drive. So sometime the subacute presentation can be with these problems. And in mellitus which are late diagnosed, they may be presenting with the complication of the type 2 diabetes mellitus, which are, it can be the staphylococcal skin infection. Staphylococcal skin infection. It can be microvascular complication, which are retinopathy. Or whenever you are going to see eye specialist or ophthalmologist, he will do the fundoscopy and will find their problems, very specific features on the retina of the eyes. It can be the polyneuropathy, wherein you will have, or the patient will complain of the tingling or pins and needle sensation in the arms. There can be macrovascular complication. What are the microvascular complication? Are the retinopathy, polyneuropathy, and also the nephropathy. Sometimes these patients are diagnosed with their kidney problem and it turns out to be a diabetic nephropathy. And the macrovascular complication, Other than here, it can also be the erectile dysfunction or the loss of the libido. Erectile dysfunction. They can be secondarily important, and it can be macrovascular complication. But in majority of the cases, these are the microvascular complication associated with the type 2 diabetes mellitus. The microvascular complication can be, it can be MI, myocardial infarction, or it can be cerebrovascular accident or the strokes. So if you are to ask the patient about the clinical feature or why the patient has come to the hospital, it can be the acute presentation, it can be subacute presentation, it can be the complication associated with the type 2 diabetes mellitus if the person is the lately diagnosed case. So once you suspect that this patient may be a case of the diabetes mellitus, and it may be a type 2, because type 1 obviously is the age, is the acute presentation which is very prominent in those patients. But if you suspect that this patient may indeed be, can be a case of the type 2 diabetes mellitus, then how you are going to diagnose them? Let's make it very simple without going into much of the complicated issues. You will do three very important tests. So how you diagnose these patients? Diagnosis of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. You will do three very important tests. One, you will do fasting blood sugar level. Fasting blood sugar level. The patient hasn't taken the breakfast and hasn't eaten anything else. You check the blood sugar. It may fall into the three categories. Less than 106, 106 to 126. This is milligram per deciliter. This is milligram per deciliter, or it may be more than 126 milligram per deciliter. So if it is less than 106 milligram per deciliter, it's normal. If it is 106 to 126, it can be either pre-diabetic or it can be impaired fasting glucose level. Impaired fasting glucose level. In either case, whatever way you categorized it, the person has got a higher chances of developing not only the diabetes mellitus in the future, but patient has got a higher risk of developing the microvascular especially and macrovascular generally, because that is the arterial problem. Complication as a result of being in this category. But if the patient has got a fasting blood sugar which is higher than 126 milligram per deciliter, and you check it on more than two occasions if the patient is non-symptomatic, and if patient is symptomatic and you check it once and it goes higher than 126 milligram per deciliter, the patient have got a higher chances of having the type 2 diabetes mellitus. So this is fasting blood sugar. Then comes the random blood sugar. So you check, you snap check the blood sugar after the meals. Fasting, no, it will be known as the random blood sugar or postprandial blood sugar level. So the postprandial or random blood sugar, if it is more than 200 milligram per deciliter, more than 200 milligram per deciliter, then the person, if symptomatic, you need to have one along with the fasting blood sugar level. Then you can label the patient as diabetic. But if it is less than 200, there is another thing. In sometimes we, during the pregnancy and during like adult life, we also do another very important test, which is related with the random or postprandial blood sugar. We do the glucose tolerance test. Glucose tolerance test or GTT, wherein we mix 75 gram of the glucose in 300 ml water and we ask the patient to drink it. Now when the person drinks it, then after at least 120 minutes or 2 hours, we check the blood sugar level. If it is more than 200 milligram per deciliter, it's the glucose tolerance test is positive, then the person has got a higher chances of having the diabetes mellitus. But if it falls between 140 to 200 milligram per deciliter, then patient is in the impaired glucose tolerance test category. And if it is less than 140 milligram per deciliter, then the chances are that the person will be non-diabetic. So this is a random or postprandial blood sugar level, which we also associate with the glucose tolerance test. This is done in suspicious cases or in cases of the pregnancy. Now the last important test in this category to diagnose the type 2 diabetes mellitus will be hemoglobin A1C level. Hemoglobin A1C level or HbA1c or A1c. This is what some people call it. Now, this in the lifetime of the hemoglobin, it gets attached with the glucose. So the glucose gets the hemoglobin gets glycosylated. And the lifespan is around like 6 weeks for the hemoglobin. So if you check the HbA1c level, that shows the level of the blood or average level of the blood sugar inside of the our body of over 6 weeks probably. Initially it was thought that it may be around like 3 months, but it's around like 1.5 to 2 months or 6 weeks. So if the HbA1c level is more than 6.5%, you can put the patient in the category of the diabetes, but some authorities take it around like 7%. So if the value of the HbA1c, which we take in the percentage, is higher than 6.5 or 7, we call them diabetic. And if it falls between 5.4 to 6.4%, these are the pre-diabetic patient. And those who have got a level lower than the 5.7%, these are the normal people. They have got no diabetes. So this is how we diagnose the patients of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. Now, once we have diagnosed this patient, let's talk about the treatment. How we treat this patient. First of all, always tell them to take good care of the diet. This is very important. This is totally unjustified if you put the patient right away on the medications, because that will not work the way it should work once you have motivated the patient. So how these patients are treated? Treatment. Now that in the treatment category, one of the most important thing is to educate the patient. Educate the patient. Because if you do not give proper education to the patient and the family, misinformation will take its place. You need to tell the patient that there are so many people who are suffering from the type 2 diabetes mellitus or diabetes mellitus. You are not the alone. And they are going through the same process. They are having a very happy life, and try to make a group of the diabetics, and they can have a get together after every certain days, or for example for a couple of times in a month, so that they come to know each other, and they should know that there are other people who are living with this chronic disease. This is to avoid depression, because otherwise they will have the psychological issues, because they will think that they are singled out as an individual who are supposed to take the medications on the daily basis for a long period of time, who are to avoid so many accessories of the life. They cannot take the diet as the other people are taking. So you are to educate the patient. Then make a dietary plan for them. Diet plan. This is again very important. Ask them to avoid junk foods. I ask them to avoid the confectionaries or the bakery items. Advise them to take vegetables and the fruit at least 5 times a day, and advise them to avoid too much alcohol, and ask them if they are hypertensive to take salt, which is less than 6 grams per day. And please make a very good plan for the fats, carbohydrates and proteins. Give them protein, give them carbohydrates. 70% of energy will come from the carbohydrates. Proteins are needed for the muscles and the enzymes, and 30% of the energy should come from the fats, and it should be polyunsaturated. So, and they are to avoid the saturated fats. After a diet plan, you need to tell them that they need exercise. At least 30 minutes a day, 30 minutes a day, and 5 times a week. In a week, they are supposed to do an exercise which should be a sort of strenuous one, and it should be of the 30 minutes. But do tell them if they are on some medications for the diabetes, they can go into the hypoglycemia. But exercise is very important, as I already mentioned. Our weight gain, our obesity is more related with our inaction rather than higher intake. If your intake, this is what happens in majority of the cases, that you cannot stop your intake as much as you can go for the exercise. So keep it as a routine. Go for the exercises that will avoid you for the obesity, which is the central point for the type 2 diabetes mellitus in both the poor and the rich countries. So exercise is very important. Once you have made these plans, once you have for 4 to 6 weeks or 1 to 2 months, you have asked the patient to carry out these thing, and even then the patient's blood sugar is not coming down, then you are to go for two things. One is oral medications, oral treatment for type 2 diabetes mellitus, and insulin treatment for type 2 diabetes mellitus. Now here comes the real understanding. Type 1 patient will be directly put on the insulin because they have got an absolute deficiency of the insulin because of the immune destruction of the beta cells of the pancreas. That is why we keep on hearing the HLA association in those patients. But in cases of the type 2 diabetes mellitus, there is not immune or complete destruction of the beta cells, but there is a resistance to the insulin. So you will favorably start in these patients the oral therapy or oral treatment, and that should be our first goal. The drug of the choice in majority of these cases is the metformin, which is a biguanide, and it's a metformin. In Pakistan and probably in the rest of the world, the most famous names for the metformin are the brand names are the glucophage and the neodipod. So we put the patient on the metformin. What does the metformin does? It does not increase the insulin secretion, but it does two very important effect on the body. It decreases gluconeogenesis inside the liver. It also decreases the resistance of the insulin on the receptor, on the peripheral receptor, on the muscles, on the adipose tissue. So it makes the insulin to work. This is the good side of the biguanide. What is its downside? It causes many epigastric problems. It can cause nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. So whenever you see a diarrhea in these patients, always first rule out the cause as the metformin. Secondly, all those patients who have got renal and liver problem, they are very much prone to develop lactic acidosis once they are put on the metformin. But this is a drug of choice, otherwise it does not cause an increase in the weight. So these are given to the obese patient, but they can be given to the non-obese patient. But obese patient or the favorite client for the metformin or the biguanides. So it causes the lactic acidosis, and it can also cause the diarrhea. But there is another very important clinical application associated with the metformin. Whenever these patients, obviously diabetics are more prone to have kidney issues, and they patient need contrast injection at any point in their life. For example, if they are undergoing angiographies, if they are undergoing MRI with the contrast, CT scan, CAT scan with the contrast, then you are to stop the metformin or for at least 48 hours before the procedure and 48 hours after the procedure. And once this has been excluded, that there is no renal deterioration or the function of the kidney is fine, then you can reinstitute or restart the metformin. So out of all the oral agents, this is a drug of the choice. Now second comes the sulfonylureas. Sulfonylureas. Now, what is the mechanism of actions of the sulfonylureas? Again, let's go back to the same diagram where we seen that if I make a beta cell, and this is a cell membrane. We had seen that there are GLUT4 receptors. These are the GLUT4 receptors. Glucose came in and there happened the metabolism. Glucose made the ATP. Then what happened that there was another receptor which we call the ATP sensitive potassium receptor or channel. Now this is where the potassium goes out of the beta cells. This is ATP sensitive potassium channel and it was inhibited by the ATP. Now sulfonylurea does that same thing. It also inhibits the potassium receptors. It will not let the potassium go outside of the cell, which will depolarize the membrane, and it will cause a lot of calcium influx, which will make the release of the insulin from the secretory vesicle to the outside of the beta cells possible. So this is how the sulfonylurea work. Now there are certain names which are famous for the sulfonylureas, and the famous one are, for example, we keep on hearing these words. It can be, these are the tolbutamide. These are all the categories. Tolbutamide, which is a very short acting, and it's a drug of choice in elderly, and it is not used in the renal impairment patient. Then we have glimepiride, which is again goes out of the body through the kidneys, but it is a drug of choice for the liver patient, or it's not used in those patients who have got a renal pathology, and it's a long acting, it's not a short half-life drug, it's a long half-life drug. So glimepiride is another sulfonylurea. Then glibenclamide is used, and it's a diurnal, again a long half-life, should not be used in the elderly, and it can cause a severe hypoglycemia. Then other than glibenclamide, we can also use gliclazide, and we have the option of glipizide, and we can also have option of chlorpropamide. So these are the sulfonylurea which we can use in the patients of the type 2 diabetes mellitus if we are to avoid the biguanides or the metformin. What are the sulfonylureas? These are tolbutamide, glimepiride, glibenclamide, gliclazide, glipizide and chlorpropamide. So we are to be very careful about the renal function, and these are in majority of the cases, these are used when the patient is not obese, is thinly. So sulfonylurea, though they can be used together, both the metformin and the sulfonylurea along with the insulin, but obviously it can be solely used in these patients as well. So in the drug options, what are others option? Then there are very famous option which we call the thiazolidine diones and are the glitazones. Thiazolidine diones, for example, it's the pioglitazone. These act more like the metformin. They do not increase the secretion of the insulin, but they rather decrease the resistance of the insulin on the peripheral tissues. They were once the very favored drugs, but now only pioglitazone survives the onslaught of the side effect, because there was a rosiglitazone which caused so much heart failure that it was withdrawn from the market. There was troglitazone which caused so many liver failure that it had to be taken off the market. So now only the pioglitazone survives. But these are again, the thiazolidine diones are important group otherwise, and they can be used along with the biguanides, sulfonylureas and the insulin, especially the sulfonylurea and insulin, they can be used with the thiazolidine dione. Then comes the important drugs of the dipeptidyl peptidase 4 inhibitors. This is again a very specific class of the drugs, which is the oral agent used in type 2 diabetic. Dipeptidyl peptidase 4 inhibitor are famously known as DPP4 inhibitors. What are the name of the drugs in these? Very famous name are the valiglipton, sitagliptin, saxagliptin, linagliptin, and allogliptins. So these are gliptins, are the dipeptidyl peptidase 4 inhibitor. Now what does the dipeptidyl peptidase 4 inhibitor does? It inhibits the dipeptidyl peptidase 4 enzyme. What does this enzyme does? It actually inhibits the two very important peptides in our body. One is known as the glucagon-like peptide, or GLP, and one is known as the glucose-dependent insulotropic peptide, or GIP1. Now, in 30% of the, these have got a 30 to 70% ratio. From the duodenum, GLP is released, which is the glucagon-like peptide. And from the ileum, from the L-cell of the ileum, the GIP, which is the glucose-dependent insulinotropic peptide, are released. Why? Whenever we eat glucose, they are released from the K-cell and the L-cell of the duodenum and ileum respectively. Why they are released? Because once they are released, they go to the pancreas and they cause the secretion of the insulin from there. So when these peptide inhibitors are used, they inhibit that enzyme which inhibits the function of those the very important peptides. That is known as the incretin effect. Now once that enzyme is inhibited, it does not destroy the GIP1 and GLP. So this is how they increase the level of insulin in the body, and this is how they cause the control of the glucose management in type 2 diabetic patient as a better option. So this is again dipeptidyl peptidase inhibitor are used, but they can also cause the acute pancreatitis. So this example, after this we have in the oral category, we have meglitinides. We have the options of the meglitinides, which is repaglinide. Very important example. But there are in certain countries, some people do use sodium glucose transporter 2 inhibitor, which are canagliflozin is, for example, glifosinate is one example, and dapagliflozin is another example, and empagliflozin is another example. But these are not much used in the majority of the world. So these are the oral treatment which are used. Then there are other therapies. For example, you can ask the patient to use the orlistat, which is a adipose tissue inhibitor. You can ask the patient to lose the weight by other agents. And finally, if you have exhausted every option to lose the weight and body mass index stays more than 40, then you can go for the option of either the gastric bypass surgery or gastric stapling. Now, gastric stapling is a good option as compared to the gastric bypass surgery because it has got its own complication. Once you staple the stomach, patient will be eating less and patient will lose the weight and patient will have a very good control of the diabetes. It always goes back to the obesity. Obesity is a huge problem. So, after we have talked about the oral management, now let's talk about the insulin treatment for the type 2 diabetes mellitus. Once your oral management is failing, and which will ultimately fail because the beta cells of the pancreas, they get exhausted, they will stop secreting more and more insulin, and you will have to give the insulin along with these medications. So let's talk about the insulin management of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. There are three types of the insulin. Insulin has got two chains, A chains and B chains. Insulin, as we had seen, was formed by the beta cells. Patient hasn't got any insulin now. Now, initially it was given from the, it was synthesized from the meat and also from the pig source. But now it's a biogenetically formulated insulin, and we inject the bacteria with some DNA probes, and this is how we make a lot of insulin, and it can be short acting. The types of the insulin are ultra short acting. It can be short acting. It can be intermediate acting. Intermediate acting. And finally, it can be long acting. Long acting. So the example of the ultra, now one thing which is very important. Insulin has two chains, A chains and B chains. It's a combination of the amino acids. We just change a sequence of the amino acids, or we take out some amino acids and we add some amino acids, and this is how we make one after the other insulin. That's all. And why it's ultra short acting, why it's short acting, why it's intermediate acting, why it's long acting, it's based on their mechanism of action, its duration of action, how rapidly they start their action and how rapidly they wean off. The faster they start action, the faster they go away from the body. Yeah, the longer they take to start their action, the longer they'll stay inside the body. And it depends upon the reabsorption process, how they are released from their source. So this is how, what is the example of the ultra short acting? These are Lispro and Aspart. Lispro and Aspart. We use these in patients once they have taken the meal. These are used along with the meals, or once they have taken the meal, the glucose will go high and they'll just capture the glucose and throw it inside the cell and they die off. So they are the ultra short acting. They have their action only for a few minutes once person has taken the meals. Now the short acting insulin are the human insulin. Human insulin are soluble insulin. We also call it the regular insulin. Its duration, duration of start of the action is 60 to 90 minutes, and it stays in the body, or it acts in the body for 6 to 8 hours. So this is an example of the human insulin or the soluble, and it's a short acting insulin. Then comes the intermediate insulin, which is known as the NPH. And also the isoflavone insulin. Its start of the action takes around like 1 to 2 hours, and it stays in the body up till 12 hours. So in majority of these patients, these are used is in the twice a day, these are used in thrice a day, and these are used after every meal. So this is how the duration of the action will have its effect on the choice of the doctor to give how many times a day the patient should be given the insulin. Lastly, long acting insulin are, for example, glargine, and it may be Detemir. They stay in the body for a long period of time, and they are prescribed for 24 hours a day. You need to give them only once dose in order to avoid the hypoglycemia, which can have its deleterious effect. So ultra short acting are the post meal, are along with the meals. Whenever some person eats anything, they have no effect after that. These are used for moderate time, for example 6 to 8 hours. These are given twice a day, and it's a once a day. Now there is a routine that some people, after every meal, they use this as a post meal, and they have basal, either NPH or long acting. Certain units are given. They keep its function for a longer period of time. A very good strategy is to mix both the short acting and the intermediate acting. Now we have mixed TARD, or the mix of both these insulin, in the 30% of the regular and 70% NPH. They are combined together and we call it the mixed TARD 70-30. These are pre-mixed insulins and they have a very good effect, because what they do, that once the patient is about to take the meals and is given insulin, this short-acting insulin will have its effect, and it will try to control the post-meal glucose surge in the body. And NPH, which is 70% of the amount of the insulin given in the mixed TARD or pre-mixed, it will keep acting on the glucose metabolism and glucose surges during the two meals. So this is how these are mixed together. And long acting insulin was once thought that it's a favorable thing, but it has been dropped. Now these are the IV subcutaneous insulin, and IV are only used in the type 1 or diabetic ketoacidosis or other complications. So these are given subcutaneously, and in majority of the cases it is important to check the blood sugar at least twice a week. And it should be done on those days 4 times a day to properly monitor the blood sugar level while we are using the insulin. Because there are two school of thought. One is the conservative way of managing the diabetes mellitus, and one is the intensive way of managing the diabetes mellitus. Now, the intensive way of managing is to keep the blood sugar level within the normal level. But there is a problem with it. Patient can go into the hypoglycemia compared to the conservative group. Conservative group is the one which does not bring the blood sugar level within the normal glycemic range, but tries to keep it a little higher than that range. So always try to make a plan for the patient, and the best plan is to check the blood sugar level regularly. If you are put the patient on the insulin, you are to avoid hypoglycemia. Hyperglycemia can cause complication, which are the microvascular and macrovascular, and it will take years and years. But hypoglycemia can kill a patient within half hour, within 15 minutes. It can cause the neuroglycopenic syndrome within 5 to 7 or 10 minutes. So please avoid hypoglycemia. Always educate the patient in detail that how to avoid the hypoglycemia, how the patient is supposed to carry some simple sugars all the time. And whenever patient feels vertigo, feels that he's going to just knock out, then patient should take the simple sugars. And family needs to be educated along with the patient, because sometime patient, if God forbid, goes into the hypoglycemia, the nearest people will be the family. So they need a very proper education. Along with this insulin, there had been inhalational insulin. It was formed inhalational insulin. A formulation of the insulin was formed wherein the patient used to sniff the insulin, but it didn't work. It was withdrawn from the market in 2007. It not only that it didn't work, but also it caused lung cancer higher than the normal people. So you are to avoid the complication, especially the hypoglycemia. You are to make a very proper plan for these diabetic patients. You are to prevent the psychological complications. Try to make a group of the people who are type 2 diabetic, who are on the drugs like oral medications or insulin. They should sit together at least couple of times in a month. They should share their experiences. This is how they can be avoided from developing the depression. These patients needs not to have the stresses, because once they have the stresses, there will be the release of the stress hormones, which are the glucagon, which are the cortisol, which is the adrenaline, which is the growth hormone, and that will counter the effect of the insulin. The stress hormone, they increase the glucose inside the body. They favor the gluconeogenesis. They favor the formation of the glucose from the non-glucose sources. They favor the glycolysis, which is the breakdown of the glycogen formation of the glucose. It is the glycogenolysis and then the glycolysis where the glucose is sent to the blood. So always try to avoid giving stress to these patients. So I hope that's all for the type 2 diabetes mellitus. And in the next video, we will talk about the type 1 diabetes mellitus. And after the next video where we will talk about the type 1 diabetes mellitus, some other time we will make a video on the complication of the type or both of these diabetes mellitus. So diabetes mellitus is a very important topic. Try to know real stuff about it, because it's a day-to-day life problem. You need to come across these patients, you need to educate them, you have to spend some time with them. A larger proportion of our population is now going to suffer from these problems, because the better are the resources, the affluent, more affluent will be the society, and more will be the prevalence of the diabetes mellitus. Giving you two extreme example. If you go to the rural area of the Pakistan, and I mean the real rural area, where the people are working in the fields, and they are taking saturated fats a lot, but they are burning them. So they do not develop the diabetes, because whatever they take, they just burn it out. And that explains to us how important it is to go for the physical exertion. Always do the physical exertion, always do the exercises. And recently, there was an example, there was a video in which it was shown that the patient was on the ventilator in Britain, and she wished by writing that she wants to swim. And the brave workers and the staff nurses over and the doctors, they made it possible. Even when the patient was on the ventilator, she was put in the swimming pool in a very controlled environment. You can check it on the YouTube. And this is how the patient did the physical exertion. So this is very important to always educate people to go for the physical exertion. Another example is World War II. During the World War II, there was less amount of the food available to the people. And the diabetes mellitus incidence and prevalence dropped rapidly. So always see what you are eating, and always see if you have eaten something, did you burn it out or not. So this is important to educate the people about it. So that's all about it. And if you like the video, please subscribe the channel, and also ask your doctor's friends to subscribe the channel.